Hello and welcome. I'm Seth Boustead, and I'm the lecturer for the Grant Park Music Festival's 2021 season. The concert I'll be talking about will take place on July 30th and 31st, and it opens up with Haydn's Symphony No. 8. When I was searching around to find out more information about it, Google kept asking me, do you mean Symphony No. 88? Do you mean Symphony No. 80? No, Symphony No. 8. We're going all the way back, the dawn of the symphony as a musical form here, really pretty much invented by Haydn, at least the way that we think of a symphony. And then we go to a wonderful work by Caroline Shaw, the youngest winner of the Pulitzer Prize in music, and that is a piece called Entr'acte for string orchestra. And we will close out with a beloved favorite music from the opera Carmen by Bizet, but in this case, reimagined in 1967 by Soviet composer Rodion Schedrin in a really, really fun and vibrant way. So some new music, I think, in many respects, music from Haydn, but music that we haven't heard before. This is a wonderful mixture of gems. The fuck am I talking about? By Rodion Schedrin in a really fun and amazing way. The concert opens up with Franz Joseph Haydn's Symphony No. 8. And again, we are at the dawn of the symphony here. When I say the word symphony, people think of it sometimes as kind of the paragon of artistic achievement. You know, it was a symphony of sound. We think that way. That's really Beethoven who gave us that idea, the symphony as this titanic form of artistic achievement. Prior to Beethoven, the symphony wasn't necessarily that at all. In the time of Haydn, certainly with these early symphonies, it was just a nice piece of music that you had. You know, if you were lucky enough to be a noble family or a wealthy family, you would oftentimes have a composer in residence in your household. And that composer would write music for household occasions, when a child came of age, if there was a debutante ball, if there was a death, you might commission a requiem. These kinds of things were very, very common at that time. And Haydn was lucky enough to live with the Esterházy family. I say lucky because at that time, a composer really had to live with a family or have some kind of patron. You weren't just a freelance composer. You know, they didn't have Spotify yet. You weren't getting royalties from ASCAP. There were none of these things. You needed someone to be your patron. And so Haydn spent 30-some-odd years in the 18th century into the 19th century with the Esterházy family. And this is where he wrote almost all of his music. So this was written for Anton Esterházy. And the piece is full of what we come to expect from Haydn, a kind of sparkling wit, a sense of humor, a lot of fun. And I was going to say that this is a typical symphony in four movements. And then I remembered that Haydn really invented that format. So he's the one who made it typical. It opens up with an allegro movement. And then there's a slow movement. The third movement is in three, waltz or a minuet and trio. And then the fourth movement is usually some kind of barn burner, a fast presto kind of movement. And that's exactly what Haydn does here in this symphony. It opens up right away, no introduction, goes right into the main theme. And the theme is from Gluck, from an opera that's not performed anymore. In fact, this theme really is only now famous or well known because of Haydn and his Eighth Symphony. Let's listen to the first couple minutes, or about a minute and a half, of the opening of Haydn's Symphony No. 8. That's a little bit of the first movement of Haydn's Symphony No. 8 in G major. He launches right into this theme theme that people would have known at the time, although this opera from Gluck is not performed anymore, it would have been known at that time. And we're a little wary of doing that these days. If I like something that Caroline Shaw does, for example, I would be pretty wary to just grab that melody and put it into my latest piece. But in Haydn's time, it was considered a form of homage. And nobody was really worried about royalties. Nobody was worried about intellectual property rights, those kinds of things. So Beethoven lifts from Haydn. Haydn lifts from Mozart. Haydn lifts from Gluck. Gluck lifts from who knows who, but definitely from somebody. That was very, very common in the classical era to do that. The second movement is in a what we call a concerto grosso form, and this is a Baroque movement. Here in Haydn's day, again, we talk about the classical era, we talk about the common practice period. Well, Haydn is bridging that gap. He's really in the Baroque or Rococo era, moving in to classical, and we're firmly in the Baroque era in the second movement. A concerto grosso is where a small group of soloists pass musical material between them. I don't have time to play it, but as you listen to the second movement, imagine this idea of people kind of sharing a melody between them. And then the third movement, as I said, is a minuet and trio. And it is exactly, not this piece, but a minuet and trio from Haydn, which will inspire Caroline Shaw, which we'll hear in just a moment. So that's a pretty straightforward movement. I'll let you enjoy that one. And let's talk about the fourth movement. This is the presto. This is a fast movement. Haydn calls it a tempest. And in fact, he uses the same music later on in an oratorio called The Tempest. So he clearly thought of this as stormy music. Let's have a listen. That's a little bit of Haydn's fourth movement from Symphony No. 8, and I said he's thinking of this as stormy music. We would say it doesn't sound super stormy. It's not Beethoven stormy, but remember, we're in the Baroque era. We're in the Rococo era. There was a movement called Sturm und Drang, Storm and Stress, that was around in Haydn's day, but Haydn was never really part of it. There's always kind of a sense of reserve in Haydn, so this is about as stormy as he gets. The symphony, I played a little bit of the opening, and then I played the ending of the fourth movement by Haydn. It was a Haydn minuet and trio that inspired Caroline Shaw in her piece Entr'acte. These beautiful, beautiful, elegant movements. Haydn was a master of writing this witty, elegant music that transports you immediately to another time. Caroline Shaw has done a reimagining of a minuet and trio in her piece Entr'acte. It's a really fascinating work in many respects. The melody comes in, it never quite gets going. Whenever you feel like it's going to break into like an actual minuet and trio, for example, it starts to break down and go a different direction. The piece is interestingly moody in places. What I want to do, this is an 11-minute work in one movement, so it's hard to kind of drop the needle. What I want to do is just kind of play several different sections and show you how she changes the theme over time. So I'm going to open it up, let you hear the musical material. She starts again like in the Haydn 8th Symphony, no introduction, no fanfare, just right into the melody. And then I'm going to jump about 2 minutes in. There's this transition where everything kind of breaks down, and then the theme comes back again, but now with a counterpoint, but not counterpoint of melody, counterpoint of timbre, these kind of brush strokes in the lower strings. A big pizzicato pluck ends that section. And then the theme comes back now. All of the strings are in pizzicato. And then when the theme comes back arco, bowed, we have this really active counterpoint line in the viola. And Caroline Shaw is herself a violist, so I think it makes sense that she gave them that really fun part. And then the piece, the theme develops from there. So let's hear, this will be about 2.5 minutes. It's four different sections of the piece Entr'acte by Caroline Shaw. It's four parts, four different parts of Caroline Shaw's piece, Entr'acte. Fascinating what she does with that musical material over the whole course of the piece. So kind of a Reader's Digest condensed version of that piece. But hopefully when you hear the full thing, you'll have a sense of where you are in the work and how she's developing that material. The concert will close with Carmen Suite by Rodion Schedrin, a Soviet composer. We're in the mid-1960s now, so quite a while after the premiere of Carmen. Unfortunately, the opera Carmen actually failed when it was premiered. Bizet died heartbroken, literally of a heart attack, because the opera had some pretty risque material. There were women who were smoking cigarettes on stage, which, you know, obviously that's pretty crazy. So the opera failed at first, but then it became, of course, one of the most beloved operas in the world. The music is some of the most performed music of any kind, classical or otherwise, in the world, and it's inspired all kinds of recreations, films, ballets, all kinds of different things. And in the 60s, it was going to be reimagined as a ballet. And so Schedrin is hired to write the music for it, and he's racking his brains what to do, because he's going to try to write original music. Finally, he decides, I can't do it. The music for Carmen itself is just so great, but I can reimagine it. And so he reimagines it for percussion and string orchestra, and the effect is quite marvelous. I have to assume that you know this music. Again, Carmen is so widely performed. What I want to do is I'm going to take, this is already the most popular opera out there, I'm going to take the most popular section of the most popular opera, the Abanera, and I'm going to play, well, actually we'll do Carmen's entrance into the Abanera as reimagined by Rodion Schedrin, and then we'll listen to a little bit of Bizet just to remind you of the material that he was originally working with so you can hear how he altered it and hear the really fascinating effect that he gets, because it's very difficult with music like this that's already a masterpiece to add anything of your own, and yet Schedrin has absolutely done that, and that's why this piece is performed quite a bit. So here's a little bit of the Abanera in the hands of Schedrin, and then just to compare the way that Bizet originally had intended it. Pretty fascinating. I really like what Schedrin has done with Bizet's music. And don't forget that Bizet himself pulled many of the themes out of the opera and made suites out of this. So, Schedrin is up against the opera, but he's also up against Bizet's own arrangements for concerts. And yet he still finds a way to inject his own personality, to do something original and new with it. This will close out the program. It is a marvelous ender, a really uplifting way to send you off into musical bliss. Once again, I'm Seth Boustead. Thanks so much for listening, and hope to see you at a future talk.